Hey there, everybody. Joe here. Thanks for tuning in. I'm still working away on that job with all the clouds on the ceiling out in Plano, Texas. So progress on that, we'll have to wait. There's still more work to go on that one. I came back and I started working on this how to draw faces video that I've been wanting to do for a long time, but you know, it takes a lot of research. I haven't done a lot of real research on that. So since I started this Harry Potter painting that I was having such a hard time with, that was really the most research on faces that I've done. And so now I'm finally to where I think I found a really solid set of steps that helps me every time to get through a picture better. I'm working on a video that I'll have for sale on my site, I'll do a short and long version of it and put it on YouTube also. This is me and my brother Ben, and since I figured two brothers probably look more similar than other faces I could find, I was thinking that would be a real test of identifying the unique personality of an individual, even if they're two similar faces. I'm real excited to get that up. It's just not quite ready yet, but it will be really soon. This is the first time I've really had such a structured algorithm. I'll just say it's an algorithm because it's a set of steps that I follow in an exact order every time. I made this drawing for DSCH, who said on two videos ago, I'm having trouble with drawing a picture of John Wick. So I went and just used my new method that I've been developing to do I just used the first picture that I saw on the link. And this is the drawing right here. So really, we're drawing Keanu Reeves playing this character. So the first thing that I look for when I'm drawing someone's face is the distance between the colored part of the eye, the iris. So I'm gonna make two little circles in the middle of my paper that are exactly that. They're the colored part of the eye. This is a good place to start for me because it gives me a fairly accurate starting point for all of my proportions that will follow. There are about four circle diameters in between the two on a real typical adult male proportion. So I'm gonna do that. And what you do is you know what the norm is, and then you look for whether or not your character matches up to that average, that norm, and then if it looks a little bit off, you adjust. So on him, it looks like it fits that proportion, so I'm just going with the four lengths in between the two. So now I've got my picture set up to do a face, you know, in the middle of my paper, even though it's a little bit to the left. That's okay, it'll give my hand room to rest here. The next thing I'm going to do is put the eyelids in place. So you want to look for the slant when you're doing the eyelids and how much of the eye, the iris, they cover. So on him, his slope downward toward the nose. And when I say the slant, I want to be real specific on this. I mean, if you draw a line from corner to corner. So let's put a curve that cuts off the top of this circle, just like this. And I want to make sure that curve creates when I make the other corner, let's put the bottom one in place. The bottom one cuts off the lower part of the circle part of the eye. So let's go about right here. I think I went down a little bit too low on this. It's okay to go slow and be careful on this, just like I'm doing, because this really defines the character a lot. And so you don't want to get this out of place. So if I draw a line from corner to corner, then you can see that is a significant downward slant toward the nose. So this is going to be that dark corner of the eye. Let's put that up in place. This is kind of a level line that slopes up to this corner. Right there, you'll see different shapes. You know, sometimes you can be fooled because an eye, I'll just draw it to the side here. Sometimes an eye may have a slope that looks something like this, and then it goes down like this, and then up again. And you can look at an eye like that and say, it looks like it's tilted this way. But when I say the slant, I mean from corner to corner. So this is actually still slanting down toward the nose. And then you do the curves of the eyelids according to, you know, where they connect on these corners. Now, when you're doing the eye, also be aware of how much white space you're leaving on each side, because that also makes a big difference. So I don't want to make this eye and leave more white on the inside than the outside, because that's going to be a different look. I want to make sure that I'm getting the right proportion, because this is something that varies from person to person and creates their unique character. So you can see I shaded this corner, and that leaves a little bit less white showing than what's on the outside, and that is pretty accurate to the picture that I'm going off. So I'm going to do the same thing on this side. I'm going to make that same slope that comes down this way, makes that corner of the eye, comes across here like a level line, and then slopes upward here to the outside corner. And I think that if you're not trying to be real accurate, maybe you're just making up a character, or maybe you're doing a quick sketch, maybe you don't go quite as slow as I'm going right now. But I'm just being real careful so that I can do a good job with the explanation. I don't want to give bad instructions. So I'm filling in the darkness of this corner. Now, a lot of that disappears in the shadows of the eye socket, but right now, it's just to show you the shape of the eye. So you can see that this line coming right off that corner, this corner dips down and makes the lowest part. You can see altogether this length from this corner to the colored part of the eye is longer than this, yet there's less white space showing on this side because of that shadow that's in there. These are things that are good to be aware of as you're drawing that. But the main thing on this second step after you get the circles is to get the slant from corner to corner. That's probably the most important part of this step. Now, I'm going to go ahead and darken the eyes. When I'm making eyes with pencil, I want to make them look natural. I just go lighter at the bottom and darker as I go up toward the eyelid. And then I darken it around the edges as well, so that it leaves kind of a circular, lighter shape near the bottom of that colored part of the eye. And this picture has a lot of shadow in it, so there's no little white reflection in it. You know, he's a killer, so I think they didn't want a little twinkle in his eye. He looks dark and sinister this way. All right. So to me, these look like very female eyes, because it's real typical for a female to have this downward slope toward the nose. But as we do the rest of the picture, it won't look like that. The next step is getting the nose in place. And the way I do that is with this Superman S shape. I'm going to draw a line around the eye socket. So this is what you want to be aware of in this step. You want to get this distance to the edge of the eye socket. You'll see a shadow that comes down from the brow that creates this sloped line right here. And be aware of how far it goes out compared to the length of the eye. So it's less than the width of the eye. So I'm going to go out about that far. I think I liked that first line a little better. We'll see. I think that looks good about right there. And then you want to visualize on your character the whole triangle down to the nose and ask yourself, is it taller than it is wide? Is it wider than it is tall? How high up do the eyebrows go in comparison to the entire shape? And you can also use the height of the eyes themselves as a guide for how high to put the eyebrows. So I see on Keanu Reeves here that the eyebrows are only about one eye height above the eye. So I'm not going to go very high. I'm going to go about right there. Bring that line down just a little bit. And then I have this triangle shape that I've drawn, and the nose will fall right about there. Now, it's okay if this is not completely accurate, because the rest of the face is going to follow these proportions, and if this is stretched too high, the rest of the face will also be stretched, and it'll maintain his likeness. If it's too wide, the whole face will be wide, and it'll maintain his likeness. So I'm not going to be too concerned about having this you know, accurate down to the millimeter. But I am going to get as close as I can, just with a visual estimation. So now, even though I have this in place, I don't want to just start right in on the nose without looking at a few comparisons. The nostrils are the first thing I'm going to tackle. And so I want to identify the nostrils. Do they slope inward this way, or do they slope this way? Or I shouldn't say inward. That's kind of a relative thing that's hard to understand. Which way do they tilt? So does it tilt this way, or do they tilt this way? You'll see both things. The edge of the nostrils on one person will go this way on another. So on him, it's the first way. And they fall just below that inside white of the eye. So I can use that as a guide for where to put the edge of the nostrils. They slope like this, and then I want to get a size comparison. I can do that by looking at the colored part of the eye and saying they're bigger. They're a little bit higher than that. So that looks like a good size comparison to me. I'm going to do the same thing on this side. Right below that white of the eye, I'm going to put a slope like this for the edge of that nostril. And then I'm going to put the nose holes right under that. The next thing I want to identify is the base of the nose. Is it lower? Is it level? Or is it higher than these nostrils on the edge? On him, it's lower. So I'm going to come down here for the base of the nose. And then I'm going to put those nose holes on each side. Typically, those nose holes, you have some empty space in between. Right here, you have space. And right here, you have space. So you don't want to go all the way to your edges and make sharp corners. That might look a bit unnatural. So let's try to get that in place. And then I want to try to make the width of this little base of the nose accurate, so it's a pretty skinny little spot on this nose. Then, now I made those lines real dark. That doesn't mean that they're dark on the picture. My picture is just really defining them so that I can see where they are. But a lot of the time, you know, you'll just have a little shadow suggesting where something is. Okay, now the ball of the nose, you want to get the size of that relative. And I see that this also has a tilt to it. So on him, you know, it has a line right about here that tilts this way to get that center ball of the nose. And then he has a nose bridge that has a pretty smooth curve to it. So this is another thing that's very defining. Once I have these in place, I'm ready to put that bridge of the nose in. And I can do that by putting these shadows in place. So there's this shadow that goes up here to the brow and then makes this shadow under the eye. And I'm just using the picture to get that, but I want to be conscious of how wide this shadow is right here compared to the eye, because that's going to create a width of this nose bridge that really affects, again, the personality of the face. So even though the other side on my picture is in a shadow, I'll just mirror this side just to have that in place, and then I'll put shadows in later that might get rid of that line. So now I have this width that's in between the eyes that represents the bridge of this nose. I think that's what you call it. And I think I'll go a little bit further in, maybe a little more curve like that. I don't know. It's a visual estimation here, so I'm kind of second guessing if I have it accurate. I always get fooled on the size of eyes because they have an eyelid, so let's put that in right now. There's another line on every eye. You can look at my video, How to Draw Eyes, Eyelids, and you always have this line that goes over the top of an eye that's the eyelid. Sometimes it has a different shape where it's cut off on the top by the brow falling down, but just know that it's there and identify where this line is. And then there's one on the underside of the eye that kind of just follows the contour of that lower lid. And so I'll just make a line there for now, like so. And then I'll just kind of mirror the same lines on this side, just because I know they would be there if it was in the light. Not everyone's face is exactly the same on both sides, but you should be able to get someone to look like themselves just by making it symmetrical. That shouldn't affect their likeness too much, unless they truly have a very asymmetrical face. Alright, so now we can put a brow in place. Let's darken this. So we've got that Superman S to guide where that brow is. So I'll just kind of put a dark shadow right there and another one right here. This one kind of comes across toward the middle. Like that. It's hard for me to control my pencil. You can see I got this tight grip that I learned in grade school and never really learned how to properly hold a pencil. Here's other priorities, I guess. Okay, so now I want to get the chin in place. My next measurement is going to be how far down to make the chin. And I'll use this length to get that length. His nose is in the center between the base of the chin and the brow. I always use that measurement. I go from the brow to the chin, and then I say to myself, is the nose in the middle? And I look at the base of the nose right here, the lowest part. Is it in the middle? Is it above center? Is it below center? All three are common, and you'll see them happening all over the place. So just identify, where is it? Is it middle, above, or below? Since I know it's middle, I know that I can go this length to the chin. So I'm going to estimate that that's right here, but I'm going to check my work. So let's just take this eraser real quick and make a little mark here. See, I'm really getting down to the nitty-gritty at this point. Let's put this here. Hey, look how close that is. Oh, I can't believe I got that right there. That doesn't happen too often for me. That was lucky. Okay, so I've got a chin right here. And who knows if his actual measurements are exactly in the middle. It just looks like it, so I chose that. Now I'm ready to put the mouth in place. So it's really important that... Man, I keep spitting on my paper. I've got these little bits of spit that keep splattering. I gotta control the way I say my P's. The mouth needs to be appropriately placed. Just like the nose, between the brow and the chin, the mouth is between the chin and the nose. So that's the next step. Not the lips, just the mouth, the space in between the lips, which is really right near the same height as the bottom of the top teeth. You know, so if you were trying to be conscious of the skull, then, you know, if I was making a person smiling and showing the teeth, then I would be able to bring those teeth down. I would look for that placement according to that same measurement, nose to chin. Anyway, it's above center on him. And I think looking at it, that it looks slightly more than one third of the total distance. I always look for thirds or fourths or halves when I'm looking at proportions, because they're easy to visually identify. I can take a rectangle like this, and it's easy to say, oh, that's at about the halfway point. It's also easy for me to quickly identify one-third as about right there, because if I divide it here, that's 1, 2, 3. And it's also easy for me to identify a quarter, because it's just a half of a half, and I can visualize in my head that if I'm right here, then that looks like if I made another one, it would be right at the halfway point. And so I look for, is it a quarter of the way? Is it a third of the way? Is it a half of the way? Now, there's a lot of things in between, but if I'm good at identifying those three proportions, I can just say, which is it closest to, and how far off is it? So, like I said, I think this mouth is a little more than a third. So I think a little more than a third is about right here. So let's go ahead and... Yeah, on second thought, I think it's a little higher than that. Let's go a tiny bit higher. What do you think? I guess I'm really splitting hairs right here. I just want to be as accurate as possible. We'll go right there. So his mouth has a very slight M shape, you know, kind of like a little flying bird in the distance of a painting. You know, you just do that little M. That's the shape of this mouth right here. So I'm going to do that. I'm going to turn it this way because I don't have very good control with my pencil, and I do better pulling lines toward me. You know, I just say do what you got to do to get it where it needs to be. Okay, that looks like a pretty good mouth. And I'm being conscious also of how far past the nostrils this goes. Sometimes people will use the middle of the eye as a reference for that too. You know, whatever you want. Use the nostril, use the eye, just find which point it comes out to. What is it close to? Now, I want to get the shape of the lips right. When I know this length is right, it's time to put the lips in place. His have a rounded slope, those two peaks that are on every set of lips. Some people, it's almost non-existent, and it's almost one smooth slope, just like the bottom lip. Some people, it's very obvious. On me, they're a lot more pointed and a little closer to the middle than probably what he has. So you want to be real conscious of that shape. And you'll notice that different shapes are reoccurring over, you know, many people share the same shapes of lips, just like noses, just like eyes. We all just have different combinations of those shapes. All right, that looks pretty acceptable to me for the shape of the lips. So I'll go ahead and do a little bit of a shadow in here. And we'll go a little bit lighter on this side, a little darker on this side. Kind of gives a three-dimensional look that I'm seeing in this picture that I'm working off of. Okay, now I'm gonna put the outline of the head in place. So you can really ruin your portrait at this stage. Well, you can with every stage, but sometimes a person can overlook just how much impact this outer shape has on the personality of the face. So this is how I get it right, or at least how I get it as close as I know how. Look at the distance from the eye to the edge of the skull. It's usually about one eye width. And so I always get fooled and make it too little. I misjudge that distance. So I'm going to go what looks like a little bit more than one eye width. So I'm judging right about there. And then I want to be conscious of the curve of that cheekbone. Is it below the eye? Usually is. I'd say always has a curve just below the eye, but maybe I'm wrong. And I want to be conscious of how far above the nose, you know, because anywhere between the eye and the nose, you can have a curve on the face here, and it's going to be different on different people. So the next change of direction is going to be at the jaw. Now look at how inward that line slopes, or does it go outward? It might even go outward if it's somebody that has an especially larger than average jaw. So on him, it slopes inward and it starts to go toward the chin above the mouth. So usually that happens either at the mouth, just below the mouth, or just above the mouth. So use the mouth as a guide. Just above the mouth is where his starts to slope toward the chin. So I'm going to do this and bring it in this way. So you can see that my change of direction happens just a little bit higher than the mouth right here. Then I want to look at the width of the chin. So is that width of the chin wider than the mouth, equal to the mouth? You can make a judgment based on the mouth with that also. So I see maybe just a tiny bit narrower than the mouth. Maybe equal. It's hard when you're looking at curved lines, you know, to decide exactly where that part ends and another part begins, but the mouth is a good gauge. Okay, same thing on the other side. I'm going to slope the temple out, and I'm going to go one eye distance out and try to just mirror what I did on that left side. And if this line slopes inward and then is able to change direction higher than the mouth and connect with this line, I know that I'm on track. Okay, that looks pretty acceptable to me. And I think once I get the shadows in here, this is going to have a pretty good likeness. So the forehead is my next thing, and I'm going to gauge that off of the size of this snout area, I like to call it. The base of the nose to the eyebrow. And so that to me looks maybe just slightly higher than this. So let's go up to here. Here, let's use the old eraser measurement. We already marked that, so let's put it right here and say, okay, we've got a forehead that goes that high. I guess I made it pretty much exactly the same, didn't I? Let's just see if that looks good. All right, let's go here, and then we slope upward, and you know, even a hairline can really have, I think, a pretty significant effect on the personality of a face. But mostly because it affects head size. If I shrink this forehead way down and make the head size too small, that really changes the likeness of a person. So if I make this line, that is the top of the head, at the right height, and typically eyes are in about the middle of a head. So on him, I'm thinking that the eyes are just a little bit above center. So let's take my phone here and use that as a height guide. Yes, I still use a flip phone. All right, so we've got this distance, just a little bit shorter than my phone. Let's go here and go a little bit shorter than my phone, and maybe a little bit more short than that first measurement. So I'm pretty good with the height measurement on the hair. And it parts, one, two, comes down like this. Ears are a pretty universal shape. It's just kind of a rearrangement of the same shapes depending on the person. You have the lobe, and then you have the shape that comes out like that, and then you have the top. You can use the brow and the base of the nose as a guide for how high to put the ear. So I saw that this was just above the base of the nose, and then I saw that the top was below the brow. And then I see that the hair is right about there in relation to the top of that ear. And then you can't see that in this, can't see the hair in this picture that comes down below the ear, but you know, I saw in other pictures he has just a little bit of slicked back hair that falls below the ears right here. So let's do the same thing on the other side. Let's go the lobe right here, just a little higher than the nose, and then it goes out, in again, then the top of the ear below the brow, and then the hair that is in this picture just kind of buried in a shadow. So I'll just make it up right there, and then put the hair coming down. So the next thing I want to put in place is the cheekbones. I want to be sure I get those in the right place because they greatly affect the way a person looks. I mean, it's the skull structure. So I see that there's a natural shadow on the eye socket, and then there's a cheekbone that shows right here. And so I can just use, you don't have to follow the exact shading that's on a picture you're working off of. You know, the shading just tells you where these structures are. So if you do different shading, as long as it puts the structures in the same place, you know, you might change the direction of light on a picture, but as long as you put the shapes in the same place, so I can just use a little line here that says the cheekbone's right about there, and then I'm okay. And then I want to put these shadows that come down right here that define where the cheeks meet the mouth area. I feel like I made this mouth a little bit narrow. I could go a little bit wider. You'll notice things along the way. You know, I adjust all the time. Let's go a tiny bit wider. Like this. I saw when I was bringing that line down that it wasn't going to meet up with the mouth where I wanted it to, and that's what caused me to notice that I made the mouth a little bit narrower. So as you fill in different parts of the face, you know, you might not notice things like that. It's just good to be conscious of this original algorithm, for lack of a better word, for going through the different parts of the face. It keeps you on track. You know, if you go back and do adjustments, you know that you're in the vicinity, so you're not going to go and try making the nose a lot wider than you've got it already. You know, you'll be able to fine-tune it with small changes rather than guessing at big changes that can just wreck your picture. All right, so now I have these shadows that are the cheeks meeting up with the mouth area. And I see that they're happening above this nostril. So, you know, those typically come to the top of the nostril. So let's shade this area. And I see that that shadow goes all the way up to the top of that nostril. It's a really defined feature on his face. I could tell him, you know, if I ever met Keanu Reeves, I could say, you have great nostrils. Okay. Now, I'm ready to start putting in the shadows and the facial hair and the things that are going to make this look more like him. So let's darken this eye socket. That's gonna communicate to the viewer that this is recessed. Make it look much more like a masculine face. And I'll bring this shadow up just like I see in the picture. I'll go ahead and erase my guide here. And I'll put, actually there is kind of a shadow there. Let's just shadow that whole area. Right here, there's a little bit of a shadow here with this, you know, with this real serious look. And there's a little bit of a shadow on the forehead that to me that defines where the brow is. So I like that shadow because I have this highlight that it makes showing where that brow is. And so let's go ahead and darken this now. And you know, this is all a pretty dark area, so I'm gonna put that same eyelid in there. And this upper inside of an eye socket is usually the darkest shadow in that eye socket area. Same thing on this side. You know, we have that darkest area on that upper inside. Okay, and then this picture doesn't show a lot of shadow in here. All right, let's put a little bit of a shadow on the bridge of the nose coming down right here. So on his, it's kind of straight and not too sharp, kind of a smooth curve on this picture. So I can pretty much do a soft, straight up and down shadow area. And it's probably good enough right there. And then let's put this shadow coming down here. And then that's going to connect to his facial hair coming down. So this might be fun getting this in place. It'll really start looking like him when I get this in here. So now this is going to really define where cheeks are. I'm making an angle of facial hair coming across the jawline here. So I want to get it right. Comes down here and it's above the mouth where it comes over. And then he's got a mustache here. Let's put this in place. Just roughly. And I'm going to put the mustache in place also so I can use them to make sure that each other are in the right place. Let's put this mustache here. And that mustache looks like it comes right about that far according to the eye. I'm looking at a line going right up to the eye. And it goes like this. Okay, same thing on the other side. Even though it's probably not exactly the same thing, it's just close. All right, we have a mustache that kind of makes a straight line down this way and then connects to some more scruff coming down here. All right, and then we've got a little goatee under the lip. And And I see the hair coming down this way. See, all I'm doing is just making the shadows. I'm not worrying about trying to make any hair texture here because that's not what's going to make it look like him or not like him. Right, that shadow comes this way. Now you can see how that shadow created a cheek area, and that really defines the expression of this face a lot, is that shape of that cheek area. So I want to make sure I get the slope of it right. I feel like it's sloped a little more than what I have it, so I'm going to bring it in like this. And maybe not, you know, sometimes I get it wrong and have to readjust. I'd say all the time I get a lot of the picture off from where I would like it to be. But I just have a real good guide in my head for adjusting that keeps me on track. All right, we've got this. Now there's a real dark line where the light's lighting up the face, but the hair down here is staying dark. So I see facial hair coming up this way, and maybe making a shape that's right between the nose and the mouth. Comes up toward the sideburn. Just like the other side, it kind of defines this cheek area, cheekbone. You know, I really don't like movies like this with so much just endless slaughter. I just saw a quick compilation of cuts on YouTube from the movie. I didn't watch this movie myself. I'm sensitive, you know, I'm a sensitive guy, and seeing so much manslaughter just really gets me down. But that doesn't mean we can't appreciate how handsome Keanu Reeves is. Okay, so now we can make this slick back hair. Now hair, I have a quick little video about drawing hair. I don't remember what I titled it. Probably how to draw hair. But the reflection that you see on hair typically runs cross-grain to the uniform direction of the hair. So this hair is all nicely combed the same direction, so there's a reflection going around at cross-grain, you know, 90 degrees to that. So I'm going to go dark right here on the line where it connects to the head, and then I'm going to put the dark lines in here where there's divides, and who cares if it's not in the same exact places as the picture I'm working off of. You know, I'm just getting the angles, making some areas darker than others. It's easier if I turn my picture like this, and then if I do the same thing on this outer edge, so I'm dark on this inner edge, and I just make it that direction, like this. A few dark lines that cross into the reflection area. Then I do the same thing on this outer area. Then it'll just appear as that natural reflection that happens on shiny hair. It typically doesn't go all the way across. You know, I won't have that reflection area going all the way around the entire head. It's not like that in the picture either. So let's just darken this. Notice how I keep bringing my lines from the outside in so that I have more of a tapered, you know, kind of a gradient look to make that reflection in there. Let's erase these sketchy lines right here. Make it look a little bit cleaner. Ears are, you know, the same set of shapes on each person, just a little bit rearranged. So you can learn what to look for. And that really makes your job simpler when you know what you're looking for, rather than just looking at an unfamiliar shape and trying to accurately duplicate it. So I know that, you know, there's that ridge that goes across the top of the ear, so I just look for where that shadow is, not if that shadow is, because I already know that it's there somewhere, typically. Let's do the same thing on this side. Let's go this shadow, and then we kind of this way. Then we have a little bit of a shadow that comes up in here where the ear hangs over and then is covered by the hair. All right, I think that it would look good to put a little more shadow here under the eye. And let's put some dark hair right here, even though I don't see it in this picture. I think the eyebrows could go a little darker, maybe darken the eyes. You know, I'll just play with the values, get what I want to stand out. I kind of gradually go across the picture to make sure that I don't, you know, I don't like having to use the eraser a lot to adjust values on the drawing, so I'll gradually make things darker as I need them, jumping around on the picture. Now the eyes look like they're a little bit close together to me, and the thing that you deal with is if you move one thing, you change the proportion, so the I made them a little close together. I made the nose in relation to that and everything likewise. So my thought is that maybe I could just make them a little bit bigger. And I'm going to see if that helps. I'll just, so that I don't change my proportion of the nose lining up with the whites of the eyes. Because if I just move them apart, you know, then that's going to change that ratio and everything else will be look different. So I'll just go a little bit bigger on the circle, like this, and maybe I can pull them a little further apart by erasing some of this. And I think that it's just very slight. I was afraid of it changing my other proportions, which I think it has, but I think I can adjust accordingly. Let's see if we can clean up some of my smudgy. This is something I was never good at, is making a nice, clean drawing. But temple shadows really define the shape of a skull. And so if I make sure to put those, I did put it in on this side. Maybe this is just me being a perfectionist, but now that this picture looks more finished, it just feels like I made the hairline a little bit high and maybe the top of the head a little bit too low. So I mean, I just think if you see those things, then you're fine-tuning your ability to see by messing with them, you know, and adjusting. Now the slanty eyes that I made are a little bit too slanty, I think, just a little bit. So I can adjust that pretty easily just by lightening my lines. And since it's easy to see where my old lines were, that makes it easier to adjust by putting new lines in. I'm actually gonna try pulling the eyes apart even more just because it had a good effect the first time. Maybe I still could go further and have it look more accurate. Wouldn't be the first time that I made eyes too close together. All right, so same thing, I'll just lighten the areas that need to scoot over. Yeah, like I said, you know, you want that white space to be in proportion. This white space is a little more than this white space, and so I brought that curve out and up a little more. Yeah. This one, I don't know if it matches, but it's all in the shadow, so I think it looks good enough.